Not so long ago, we stumbled across a Reddit post in our Chernobyl. A curious user shared this short clip asking, what the hell is this device? It seemed simple enough, just a metal installation standing near the central stadium in the city of Pripyat. Though it looked to me oddly familiar, and I recalled that previously I had seen the same device from another angle in the photo album Name of a Star Chernobyl, published in 1996. So we decided to dig in our papers to find out more, and it turns out the story behind it is really interesting. And it shows how ingenious were some of the solutions developed straight in Chernobyl. This device is a special sampler, and it was a part of a large and very important experiment conducted in the early period following the Chernobyl disaster. In fact, the network of these devices helped scientists to understand a great deal about the uncharted territory the Chernobyl zone had become. So, what was it all about? As many of you know, after a catastrophic explosion of the Unit 4 at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, there was a powerful release of radioactive substances from the destroyed reactor. And where these substances fell, they created a patchwork-like contamination that still defines the shape of the Chernobyl zone. But a large amount of these isotopes were in the form of fine microscopic dust. So in the early period, they formed radioactive aerosols, which could travel for miles. This is why being in Pripyat or anywhere around without breathing protection meant guaranteed inhalation of radionuclides. Which, I have to say, is far more dangerous than outside exposure, which can be reduced by planning time and routes carefully. So, gathering information about aerosols became a top priority, but there was one big problem. In many places, energy supply was yet not restored and communication was quite chaotic, and most of the existing monitoring stations had been knocked offline. And yet, scientists needed to find a way, so they decided to create devices which will use the contaminated wind itself. A key element was so-called HEPA filter. This is a type of filtering clothes made of randomly arranged fibers. It can filter nearly 100% of particles down to half a micrometer in size, and actually you can find them in many places, starting from hospital equipment and ending with many types of vacuum cleaners. The first filters for radiation particles were created during the Manhattan Project, but in the USSR, a similar technology was independently developed by chemist Igor Petrianov-Sokolov. He created a large variety of filters called FPP material, which got the unofficial name Petrianov's filters. These materials became the base element of many monitoring systems in the Chernobyl zone, and they are still in use today. And here is an example of one of those first samplers. So technically it is a wind vane, which follows the wind direction, with a passive propeller for greater accuracy. The air passes through a tube, delivering particles to a cone made out of Petrianov's filter. Then this filter is removed and placed into a spectrometer. That's a special device that can identify nuclides, their activity and concentration. So this is how scientists got the much needed data. In a similar way operate aspiration systems. The principle is somewhat the same as in a vacuum cleaner, so there is a powerful blower that intakes the air and a set of Petrianov's filters. However, the initial experiments indicated a few problems with this approach. The wind passing through the tube would actually leave many dust particles inside it before they even reached the filter. Similarly, when the air entered the structure of the aspiration system, it changed speed and direction. And this is where the PB1 air samplers came in. It didn't have any motors or pumps, instead it let the wind do the work. Air entered through this large opening, passing through a cone made of a Petrianov's filter. With no obstacles, the cone could trap dangerous radionuclides even when their concentrations were extremely low. And behind the filter was a propeller-based anemometer, which, together with the rotation mechanism, detected the speed and direction of the wind. This all connected to a counting circuit based on an electromagnetic impulse counter powered by batteries, and it registered every 10,000 rotations of the anemometer. The typical exposure time was from 10 to 15 days, and during that time 600 to 6,000 cubic meters of air would pass through. Moreover, if a sorption filter was used instead, it could even detect radioactive gases. Once the exposure was over, the filter was removed, and parts that secured it inside the sampler were cut away. Using a hydraulic press, the rest was compressed into a pew of roughly 1.5 inches in diameter, which was then placed inside a spectrometer. This simple solution proved so effective that in 1987 a network of 72 such devices was created. They were placed strategically at various distances and directions from the nuclear power plant. Over 1200 air samples were gathered during that year alone, in addition to data from 19 CS aspiration systems. Specifically, 13 PB1 samplers equipped with sorption filters were installed in the village of Kopachi and at the fuel base site next to the city of Pripyat. This provided crucial data during the restart of Unit 3 of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, detecting possible releases of radioactive gases. But there was one more problem. As you probably know, there was non-stop traffic on the main roads of the zone, and that had an impact. So later, someone at the radiation safety department in Pripyat had an idea to install a couple of PB1 samplers on a car. The car would drive a designated route at a steady speed of roughly 30 miles or 50 kilometers per hour. This allowed the discovery that the concentration of radionuclides on the roads was 10 to 100 times higher than away from them. This data helped enhance safety protocols and develop better protection for people. So this was just one single example of how a simple solution greatly improved our understanding of the dangers hidden in the Chernobyl zone. But in reality, there were many more very interesting methods of detecting and analyzing radiation. Starting from the famous Project Beacon, which included positioning probes inside the destroyed reactor, to truly ingenious inventions like gamma visors, which allowed to literally see radiation. We will talk about that in future episodes. If you made it this far, thank you for watching. You can find a detailed translated report about PB1 samplers on our Patreon page, along with other bonus reading which was never published before. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries, because we have many interesting things to watch. And see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.